For nuclear disarmament talks. And joining us on the line to discuss this is John Hemmings, Asia Studies Centre, from the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. John, Trump meeting with Kim, is this a gamble?
I'm sure it's a gamble, but not doing anything is a worse gamble. I mean, there's not that there's not risks involved. Of course, meeting him puts the president's life in some sort of potential danger. But I think we have to weigh up, you know, not doing anything and slowly, steadily moving towards, you know, conflict is John, also a gamble. Yeah.
Let's just have a listen to how Trump's previously spoken about North Korea.
He spoke very quietly.
He spoke extremely quietly. This is why this is
this
our
is first day,
ever show.
First
but I'm here.
Day,
yeah, we're here yeah, now. Yeah. This is yeah. how Donald Trump previously spoke about North Korea.
North Korea does not make any more threats to the United States. They will be met with fire and fury like the world has never seen. He has been very threatening beyond a normal statement. And as I said, they will be met with fire, fury, and frankly, power, the likes of which this world has never seen before.
So, John, has this bullying and bolshy approach worked?
It has in some ways. I mean, remember, the context of those talks were when we thought the North Koreans were going to fire a missile in the vicinity of Guam, which is, of course, the U.S. territory. After those remarks, they did not fire it. They suddenly grew very hesitant. You know, this is kind of rhetoric is very normal with both South and North Korea for them. It, you know, both sides use very inflamed language. So for someone like me who watches the North Koreans, it's kind of interesting to see it come from our side. I would say more his tactics with China have been the correct ones. He, unlike any previous president, he's really put the Chinese under pressure. The Dang Dong Bank sanctions, you know. But he's also put the hand out. You know, he's been very tough with both the North Koreans and the Chinese and always thanked them in tweets for being great. And, you know, today he tweeted, thank you to Xi Jinping.
Charlie Wolf here. You know, it's interesting as well when he first made a statement on this, and I remember listening to a guy from a think tank in the States, again, who would not agree normally with Donald Trump, but he said, the way he phrased it at the time, he said, you are going to force us to take action. So he didn't say we're going to take action. You know, he gave a warning. He says, you know, listen, you're boxing me in. If you continue doing this, I will have to respond. And that is his job.
Yeah, I agree. It's been unconventional, and I'm still not sure that I believe the North Korean overture. I think they're playing a long game, perhaps still buying time. But I think there's a moral imperative for us to follow through. I mean, Donald Trump said he was going to sit down with them, that he would sit down with them. I mean, he's been, what I think I am most surprised about and kind of a little bit in awe of is his diplomatic agility. He goes 1 minute from, you know, bombastic rhetoric to, sure, I'll sit down.
I mean, if you look at some of his past foreign trips, I think they've all been wildly successful, the Saudi trip and some of the others.
What's different about this, though, is no other U.S. president has sat down to have this conversation. John, why is that?
I think there's a risk. Evans Revere, who's an excellent ex-State Department guy, wrote a piece for Brookings today. I really like Evans. It's very cautious, the piece. And I can see there's a danger, of course, that, you know, personal danger to the president. The second one is that he gets there and they just yank his chain and so he loses faith. And the third one is that it legitimizes the regime to have, you know, the great president of the United States sit down with this kind of basically tin pot dictators.
Well, that is the worry. And where can they even meet? Where's neutral ground?
Yeah, peace out.
I think on the border would be safest, the Pumundon village, you know, the peace village there.
Well, John, can I ask, when you said about danger to the president, I mean, granted, the president is always in danger, whoever it is, and he's always surrounded by, you know, a bubble of Secret Service. But are you saying that you think that they would literally try, a member of the Korean government, if not Kim Jong-un himself, would try and assassinate the president?
I don't know if I'm making that allegation. I mean, it does sound far-fetched when you say it out loud. It's just that, you know, all through the Cold War, there were random acts of violence by the North Koreans. You know, the axe-cutting incident where they attacked a number of U.S. soldiers and killed them. They killed, I think, three men with axes. for cutting down a tree on the DMZ. They also tried to infiltrate the South Korean equivalent of the White House, disguised as South Korean police, you know, murder hit squad. They got right up to the gates and engaged in, you know, they've assassinated large numbers of South Korean cabinet people. They've never attacked the U.S., but they have. I take that back. They have, you know, they nabbed an intelligence boat in neutral waters and dragged it into the USS Pueblo. So, you know, Scott Snyder, who's an excellent analyst at Council for Foreign Relations, you know, he says they perceive themselves to be a small state and a kind of, you know, against big bullies. And so they'll do often very random sudden strikes. You know, they believe in that as a tactic, both diplomatic and strategic.
Well, John, thank you ever so much for your insight. John Hemmings from the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society.
Thank you.